name is Ben Jeeva. I'm a world member of the Yankton Sioux Tribe of South Dakota. It's a great honor to be here. And thank you, Anne. I know the New York Society for Ethical Culture has been a long, long friend of the Native community here in New York and also in our affiliated communities back on reservations. So it's a great honor to be here. This was the AIM song, which is first heard at the American Indian Movement protests in the 70s. And we've been learning it at the American Indian Community House. I'd like to introduce the drummers, Zubin.
Hi, my name is Zubin. I'm Tigua from El Paso. I'm also honored to be here and to be a part of this. I'm learning to drum at a later stage in my life and enjoying it immensely. Thank you all for being here.
And he does a lot of healing in our community, running a well-variety group, and a lot of men in trouble. Seek him out.
Good morning. My name is Ronald. I'm from South Dakota. I'm also a Sioux Indian. Ben and I are in the same different communities, but the same area, neighborhood area. And I volunteer at the AICH. I'm also an artist. I work with pen and ink. Some of my art is on the website, and through Ben's help, I'm also starting to do on work on hide. And it's really great. We've never done that before. It's just mostly like a lot of empowerment coming through our working together. And this year, the drum and the drumming and singing is all new to me. There was a time I didn't want to be involved with my culture. I was pushing it away. And as a result, one individual in my workplace said, "Ron, I think you need to go back." I was like, no. But eventually I went back, and gratefully I did that. As a result, coming through the agency, I learned a lot about myself and other Native American communities here in New York and abroad in the United States. So I'm grateful to be here. Thank you.
Sparrowhawk.
I'm better known as Sparrowhawk. I am of Ndende Apache origin and Penobscot by adoption, Mulan clan. And I am a New York actor now. I will be on TV next Friday at 9 p.m. at HBO. HBO, the show is called High Maintenance, season 2, episode 2, at 11 p.m. I'm a furrier. However, we're trying to revolutionize the fur industry. Instead of hunting or caging animals for their fur, we're collecting them off the road. We're calling them roadkill or road offerings now. So we can be luxurious without feeling guilty about it. So we're trying to combine fashion and tradition rolled into one. Thank you.
Yes, hello. My name is Hawk. Good morning. I'm native here, right in New York. I was pretty much born in New York State, New York City also. My former profession was physicist and mathematician, so I did experimental physics at Bell Laboratories when it was still existing.
In New Jersey?
Yes. I've done many other things as well, but right now I guess I'm retired. But I'm not retired from my culture.
And if you could join us and stand behind Sparrowhawk,
sure.
We wanted to do a special honor song. This is a community tradition we do because Anne, when we reached out and we were like, "Oh, we're kind of homeless. We need a place to be." Sure, come on down. So we thank you and we honor you. We have sage that we bought earlier, which is our medicine that we want to give you an offering. It's from South Dakota. It's a medicinal thing that we pray with, and we burn it, and you can eat it, or you can put it in tea, or you can make a balm out of it. It has many uses, like many medicinal things. It's not just one thing. It's many things based on what you do with it. So we wanted to give that to you from Zubin and say thank you for helping us heal. And we'd like to do the Ohio song. We'll do one set like we did last night with Cheryl.
You didn't tell me that.
Okay. Ohio. So we'll do Sneak Up. Thank you.
Yagolina.
Yagolina, thank you. From the Smythe clan family. Okay. She resides in the Aka. You know, you should pronounce this. I don't want to mess it up.
Akuzasimohawk.
Thank you very much. Territory and New York City. She was born and raised on a Iroquois reservation bordering Canada and the United States. And she has always pursued an in-depth exploration of northern and southern tribal art and design. However, her studies were never limited to Native American culture. She's also studied and accomplished various degrees and certifications in fashion design, business, and leadership. Through her tribe and sheer determination, she's had the opportunity to study in Montreal, New York City, Shanghai, Beijing, and Hong Kong. Ben, who we've met, introduced himself, is the executive director of AICH and is an enrolled member of the Yampan Sioux tribe of South Dakota and is pursuing his PhD in social work at McGill in Montreal. That is quite a commute. And Rick, and could you please pronounce for me your name?
Chavoya.
Yes, thank you. Chavoya of the Chicano Nation?
Yeah.
Thank you. And he was born and raised in Arizona, and I'm looking forward to connecting with you in Arizona, actually in New Mexico, for the American Ethical Union Assembly this summer. And he has earned his BA from Boston University, MA from Boston College, since his first appointments in higher education at Northern Arizona University and Arizona State University, Rick has taught classes and directed various initiatives to advance multiculturalism, social justice, and institutional decolonization. He served as an assistant dean at Yale University, directing the Native American Cultural Center and the Latino Cultural Center. Following Yale, Rick was an associate director for the Center for Racial and Ethnic Equity at the American Council on Education in D.C., and more recently directed NYU Center for Multicultural Education and Programs. So I think there's much more to say. But you know what? I want to hear from you more than that. So I've got mine on. I'm going to come up. Is Ben here? We'll start with you guys.
They're taking it down.
Yeah, so okay. You should read it.
You should get here momentarily.
Great. Then I will.
I'm not sure why.
Okay, great. Hey, terrific. So, I want to thank you so much for being here. And Rick, could you please give me the traditional recognition of the people whose land we're on?
Well, first I'll introduce myself. My name is Haka. Memiutamenue, Rick Chavoya, Kumiai. That's a greeting in the language of Kumiai. From you, and the first thing we always do at any public event is acknowledge where we are and give blessings and thanks to the Lenape nation, Lenape people, whose land we are always on. And I, as well as many of you, probably are visitors to this land. And so it's always important for us to thank the people whose land we're on so we can continue our social life, our work, and so forth. And I also always thank the Haudenosaunee, who are also part of this area that we now call New York, and the Haudenosaunee people are very responsible for building New York City. Many of you have heard of the Mohawk Ironworkers. Those are the folks who oftentimes, even the general population, are understood to have had an instrumental part in building, literally building this city. So when you walk around and look at these big buildings, you can thank those folks for giving us a place to live and thrive here in the city. So.
And that's a nice segue to Haudenosaunee because you're from the Mohawk Nation.
Yeah, I am Mohawk. I'm from Akuzasin Mohawk Territory. It's just on the border of Canada and the U.S. So we're actually on three borders.
It's on.
It's on.
Can you hear me?
No. We're going to have to project a little too.
Okay.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
And me?
Yes. Okay. Say hello, everybody. My name is Yagolina. I'm from the Akuzasin Mohawk Territory. You might know us as Iroquois. We like to refer to ourselves as Haudenosaunee.
You know, I think it's because it's next to your microphone. So maybe if you could.
excited about the Mohawk.
I learned, I come from a family of Mohawk iron workers. Both my grandfathers were like legendary foremen here in New York City because it was the only opportunity available for us to survive. So yeah, I feel like I have a lot of journey blood in me, and that's what brought me here back and forth to find opportunity just like they have.
Hello, everybody. I'm going to introduce myself earlier. Basically, I'm an enrolled member of the Yankton Sioux Tribe of South Dakota, and I grew up in Rosebud Sioux Reservation, and I came to New York City, like many people, for school, and then it keeps you in the city.
You never go back.
It just doesn't work that way for some of us. And so I was very fortunate to run into the American Indian Community House in the 80s. And I was in trouble. I was younger. I was not living productively. And people kept saying, there's an Indian house. And I was like, what? And I literally went in, and they were like, come on in. We started singing. We had coffee. There were social health programs. And then I was a client there, and then I became a staff member. Then I became a board member, and now I'm the executive director.
They never let you go.
But it speaks to the power of community organizing, how important it is to have things like this that are there for communities. And we're a very small community of 3 million people in the United States, and about 2.5 in Canada. And New York is very unique because of the Jay Treaty. We have many Canadian Aboriginals that have come down and do ironwork. It's a treaty right to cross the border with your status card, so we do that. And the Dominion of Canada doesn't recognize the treaty in terms of us being able to work and live in Canada, but the United States does recognize the treaty. So many Canadian Aboriginals can come down and get a social security number and just work. We're not a citizen, we can't vote, but we have the right to be here because of this treaty that our forefathers, it was mainly her nation, forged with the Americans and the British for the future. And that's a lot of our story. It's somewhat historical, you know, language. Broadway's an old Indian trail, I didn't know if we knew that, but a lot of the old roads on the East Coast are old Native trails where people would travel and they would make treaties with each other. So treaty making was alive before the white man came and is a viable kind of component of this. They're almost like technological devices that have procured rights for us now so we can be up here as indigenous people, federally recognized, state recognized. Some of us are not affiliated, our communities did not sign agreements with the United States, so they're considered unaffiliated American Indians or Native people or Indigenous people. And of course, we have Indigenous people from all over too, and that's something that we could talk about with the advocacy.
It's so good to hear that there is one treaty, at least one, that is being honored and recognized by the United States, because you know your history. It's so much a history of treaties having been broken. And as my members know, I often refer to my growing up in the land of the Haudenosaunee and how I was fortunate enough in my school to have learned so much about the different nations. And what was so powerful for me was growing up, and still today, is recognizing that the great hero of the Haudenosaunee is the peacemaker. And so that's a story that we tell our children here at the Ethical Society, that's a lesson of the heroic feats that he undertook were going from one nation to another to bring everyone together. And just a couple miles from where I grew up is where the Tree of Peace with the Seneca. So burying all the instruments of war and then the Tree of Peace on top of it, and then the eagle atop who's looking out aloud for danger. So powerful, powerful stories, and also that our U.S. Constitution is derived from that Confederacy and from that peace, and it really wasn't officially recognized in the United States until a resolution of the Congress in the 1980s. So it took a very, very long time to credit your people. And speaking of your people, we would like to know, Chuck asked, the question often comes up, what is the most appropriate and respectful way to address you? And I know that it would be to address you by your nation, but we may not know that unless we get to know you. So in general, what would be the most appropriate and respectful way to do to address your nations, your people, and because we want to do it right.
I think that you said, because we don't know you, I think the appropriate way is to get to know us, and ask us in by nation is the appropriate way. We're not a general, shouldn't be a general definition for us. We all differ, in culture, ceremonies, languages, and language matters. You can't call us Indians anymore. We're not from India. Iroquois, he was showing us a few things that I accept that he might not, and he might not. So language matters, and get to know us.
I'll say one thing about the term Indian. There's different theories about its origin, right? A lot of people think it's because this guy Columbus thought he landed in India. There's another theory that actually has some good research behind it. But the term actually came from Indios. And people know Spanish. They use Indios, which means with God, because when the explorers and the early Spanish explorers came to know us, they realized how beautiful people we were. Right, and how spiritual we were, and so they referred to us. And there's more research that seems to be that could be as much the origin of quote unquote Indians as anything else. So they're both in a sense don't apply to us, but it's just interesting to think about. If you think about the perception that these colonists had of our people.
And then you said I spoke with you yesterday, and you said the AICH has a representation from about 600 different nations.
That's correct, and it is a very complex community for that reason, where we all have these individual family stories or units, and sometimes one group can have many different names. Like I'm actually an Yankee, and I'm a Dakota, and Dakota means we're friends, so we're actually friends. And then the French came, and they said, who are those people? And they said, oh, the Yanomisu, those are the poisonous snakes, they're bigger enemies. Oh, we'll call them Sioux. And so it's very complex through the history of time, where friends can then become snakes, can become Sioux, can become, and they're all in the treaties as these various names. So when you, it is a great question you ask, because it's a very complex thing, where there's currently, I believe, 2,500 legal cases against the United States government for land claims, rivers, mountains, prairies, and a lot of this rests on historical ability to be able to say, no, we are people of the tree. This is our place. That's why we call ourselves the people of the tree. So our names have a legal definition. For that reason, we still use American Indian, because it's historical and it's in the treaties, and they're always trying to get out of the treaties. Mm-hmm. Same thing in Canada. There's like 95 cases against the Crown right now for rivers and mountains and lakes and people, and this is who we are. And so when you, identity is very difficult in the Native community, even amongst ourselves. And people have been forced and removed. You got the Miami Nation, which came from originally up by Montreal, then moved to Illinois, and then Kansas, Ohio, Civil War happened, and then they're now in Oklahoma. And so, and they're called Maumees, and there's people with a Maumee, it's a bird that's on the river that fishes. And so it's like, that's their, it's just like very complex.
We both know Ada Deer. And Ada Deer has spoken here before. I interviewed her on the stage here. So if you want to go back into our archives, you can watch that interview with her. But one of the things that she was very involved with was certifying nations. And she was very stalwart about that, because so much now, it does involve legal recognition. And so she was also speaking to, as a woman, she often had challenges dealing with men in different nations asserting herself as having an important role to play. And I know that in different nations and in the Haudenosaunee Confederacy, women are very important. And one thing that was said about the Constitution, that what a tragedy it was that the role of women was not carried over into the Constitution, because it's such a strong role in that. So could you speak to us about women?
I think that was more of a convenience to yourself. But yeah, we do come from a matriarchal society, and I think that, like yesterday was Women's March, a good point to bring up is that we're here to decolonize, to have that conversation, right? We need to start decolonizing feminism and the state we're in now, and we need to start acknowledging women as, like, we're the secret. We're the ones that should be in charge. Like, we're on indigenous territory right now, and this is a matriarchal, it's naturally a matriarchal society. You know, that's what works here, and what's happening now is not working.
So good. So continue, please, that conversation among you about decolonizing New York City. That's our theme this morning. And then I hope you will include in that how we can be allies in that decolonizing. And then we'd like to open up to some Q&A from our members as well. So.
Well, just a moment on that point about matriarchy and matriarchy and matrilineal societies. The majority of our, mine included, the Kumeyaay were matrilineal. And what happened is when this very patriarchal societies, you know, Spain and England and France, which were extremely patriarchal, came to this country, we didn't want to deal with our leaders who were women. So that's kind of where it really started to switch in terms of not only leadership throughout the country, but even had an impact on leadership within our own nations. And that's why oftentimes you started seeing more men rise to leadership positions, even within our own nations, because they're the only ones that had any credibility or that the European colonists would deal with. And so those kind of things not only impacted this entire, you know, country, the U.S., but it really had a big negative impact on our leadership. And those are the kind of things that sort of the legacy, among many legacies. And that's what, you know, just to answer your question, that's what we're trying to do in terms of decolonizing, is trying to make sure people understand what indigenous knowledge is, what indigenous ways are, what life ways are, and how they were here for thousands of years, there were all these life ways and indigenous knowledge and ways in which we understood how the world was and the world, and we worked with the world. And so we're trying, little by little, here in New York City, you know, to in fact, so that's what we mean by decolonizing. We're going, trying to go to these institutions and at this institutional level and trying to bring back indigenous knowledge and indigenous ways and for them to recognize what has been, you know, overlaid onto these indigenous ways, which worked so well for thousands of years.
Yeah, but it's a very, I studied public health at McGill University in Montreal. I'm doing my PhD. And part of that process has made me very aware about the consequences of colonial decisions made in health programs against indigenous people to assimilate them. But also, it really is all groups will suffer if there's not engagement, which you talked about. It. You can get to know us and ask us, what do you call yourselves? And then you can take that further. What do you mean? How are you doing? What's going on? What are your priorities? But instead, we have a system where Ottawa will package health and social services programs and just plop it down everywhere. And we have a raging health and social crisis in both the United States and Canada because there's not that community engagement. We're citizens of New York City. We can go to a hospital if you're not, you know, if we're appalled by something, we could say, stop it, I'm paying for this. And this is my infrastructure that it must serve me. And we don't have that. It's a missing loop in our sovereignty. And so it's like a gap that creates a vacuum that's very dangerous, where people far away from you can make a decision about you. And there are other communities that suffer from this, mentally ill people, who for many times their civil rights, you know, they're thrown in jail, but they're not, you know, you're not illegal, but you know, it's not illegal to be mentally ill, but behaviors can bring you to a situation where you're considered, you know, criminalized instead of being a person with a mental illness. Same thing with women's health. We know the long history, some of us, of how women's health has been just complete. And that's what we saw yesterday in the march. It was like, my body, my control, my decision. And so these are universal issues where we all kind of pivot on them. For us, it has more of an impact because we don't have that taxpayer representation model, because we're sovereign nations in this dialogue with the states, the United States of America, and the Crown of Canada. So it creates a very dangerous situation. I just wanted to bring that to awareness because I've learned more through my studies.
So I'm interested in the ways in which you see, as you're studying for your doctorate in healthcare, the kinds of contributions that you can make given your perspective as an Indigenous person. And are you hoping to reframe or to change some of the ways that we look at healthcare? So what are your goals there, I guess?
So my thesis will study Aboriginal nurses and physicians in Canada working with Canadian Aboriginal communities, because the literature has shown them the fact that communities that have a native nurse, they do better. They don't have these end-stage diabetes things happening that other communities will have, where people are just dying from diabetes. They're using limbs, eyes, everything. Lungs shut down, it's over, that's it. The body says no more, it quits. And so that's one thing, is why are they more effective? Do they have something from a cultural perspective, or is it social, racial? We don't really know. And that's where, being a scholar, I've become very humbled by, don't assume, you know, like, ask, find out. So I'm interviewing 14 healthcare professionals, and I want to do that study in the United States too. And largely because there is a big push to educate Native people in health professions. Mm-hmm. Universities, and that's what Rick has really been involved in, is funneling Native students into professional pipelines where they can then make an informed impact in their own community.
So I'm wondering, as a feminist, are you feeling, are you encouraged that the men in your nation and in other First Nations are supporting you, or do you feel that it's a struggle for you?
That they're supporting you?
Yeah, that they're supporting you. I'm assuming that the men on either side of you are.
This is a very natural role in our structures and community. The men are there to, you know, protect us and support and hunt, you know, and women make all the big decisions and keep the family together and politics.
So have you had to, like, embrace that now, given what Rick told us about the sort of the overlay of colonists who would deal with women and that having some effect on the, you know, the societies? Are you finding that you're able to, like, go back and say, no, this is the way it needs to be, and this is the way?
Well, there's a lot of intergenerational trauma based on, I guess, like, patriarchy trying to switch the roles of our men and women. So there is that natural, like, conflict. Mm-hmm. But a lot of what we're doing on reservations now, specifically Iroquois, from my experience, is we are in the process of reclaiming our identity and decolonizing our minds. So we're trying to fish and hunt again, but the state is totally against us, gives us such a hard time. And we're also trying to plant food. We can do that. We have our land, it's federal, and we could do that without any restraints. We're kind of sovereign in a way, you know? So we don't have, you know, I guess, like, outside of reservations, like, oh, like, zoning. Mm-hmm. You can't farm here. Mm-hmm. So we basically, with what little land we have, we're trying to do that. So we're trying to decolonize our identity, our traditions, and who we are. And like you mentioned with the diabetes, a large part of that is, if I just had a family member die last last year from diabetes. She lost foot, leg, arm, finger, couldn't see. We need to decolonize our food. And like I said earlier, with the matriarchal society and what works here on this territory, I heard a comparison that Wynonna Duke mentioned before about seeds, the seeds of this territory. We're in the northeastern region. Certain corn seeds, you plant them here, they have this natural adaptation to the climate. You plant them down in California, they're not going to survive. You know, they're not adapted to that. That corn is not going to, you know, it's not going to happen there. It's not going to be good. You know, it's just, we have to just decolonize our minds and go back to traditional ways. Not entirely, but like adapt it in and realize that certain things worked before. You know, with like technology and dating and everything's going awry. We just need to work on our minds individually and start, I guess, researching and learning about traditional ways.
So Rick, you and I have had some conversations about the Southwest, and you'll be joining us at the American Afro-Union Assembly. And our theme is environmentalism. So one reason that I turned to you and to your colleagues in the Southwest with all the work that you're doing in environmentalism is that I would imagine that that's also under that umbrella of decolonizing, because we've had this overlay of unnatural ways of dealing with Mother Earth. And so, we sang to Mother Earth this morning, out of recognition of how humble we need to be and appreciative. So I wonder if you could tell us a little about that.
Yeah, and it's even though for us, when we talk about drilling or fracking or whatever other way, which oftentimes in the colonial states, it's understood to be just mining for resources, digging for resources and so forth. What we see it as a violation and an invasion of our mother. And there's no mistakes about it. We don't think of that as a metaphor. That's real. We believe you are drilling in and violating a living being, right? Every time you do something like that. So for us, it's very serious, all these things that are going on all around the world, really, but concentrating much of our work in this country. And as been mentioned, we did go out to Standing Rock. Standing Rock got a lot of attention, but we have been doing work like that all of our lives to protect Mother Earth in a variety of ways. But Standing Rock was powerful because it brought attention to our understanding of the world and what we meant when we say we're stewards of this earth and of the land, and it brought out just to many more people an understanding of how the system worked. That's kind of the most important thing, is that not only is there something going on in one particular place, there's an entire system throughout this country and throughout really the world that profits from doing these things in a way that's not necessary. There's other ways in which it can be done, right? There's other ways in which you can fuel, all the things that we have here in the world without having to violate Mother Earth. And make no mistake about it, New York City is the center of financing all these ventures, which is why decolonizing New York City is both a local issue in terms of what's around us, and many of you probably saw in the New York Times last Saturday, we wanted the Columbus statue and the other statues of representing colonization to come down. We didn't win that. If you haven't read this, it's a pretty good synopsis. You can go online and find the Times or some other articles on it. I'm not gonna say that I haven't quoted, but that's what I mean. Which is always nice. And it's nice that they got a good quote from me. Not the Times, you get this quote. So it was a good quote. But for us, we started looking not only at what's going on locally, like taking and dismantling a lot of the colonization that's going on here in New York specifically, but also the way in which New York City finances what are colonial ventures throughout the U.S. and throughout the globe, and many of them have to do with drilling, fracking, and mining, and all kinds of things like that. And so after we went to Standing Rock and we resisted on a very direct level there, we came back here and started working on the banks who finance all the things that go on throughout the country, throughout the world. So we've had a number of actions, we've had a number of protests, we've gone to board meetings of these big financiers like Citicorp and Wells Fargo, sometimes uninvited. But it's interesting about when you get into decolonization, when you get into actions, you find that you have a lot of allies. And there's a lot of ways, and Anne asked about being an ally, there's a lot of ways you can be an ally. You can support kind of things in all sorts of ways. And I'll give you one example. I won't give any names, but there was a particular board meeting going on, convening of a number of different banks that finance pipelines all over North America. And there was an ally within that company who worked in that building who understood a secret elevator that would take us up to the board meeting, right? And so we were able to send some of our people as we were doing a protest outside to get public attention to what was happening and what they were financing, this violation of Mother Earth that they were financing. We were able to get people up the elevator into this board meeting, and they were able to do a dance and talk among the shareholders within that board meeting until they got kicked out, eventually, right? But it's a great place to be because no one wants to come down harder. It's a very, if you know about board meetings, they're a very civil place. So no one wants to come rushing in with police with batons or anything. So security was called up, and they very politely kind of tried to ask the people to leave. And by the way, they were all women. They were all our women leaders, all indigenous women leaders who were there speaking. And believe it or not, there were some of the shareholders, and they said almost to a person, it was other women who were shareholders, who were applying them and thanking them for bringing this to the attention of those shareholders. Whereas the men were literally catcalling them, the same way they would on the street. They say horrible, vicious things to them. And these are major shareholders. These are millionaires who are saying, get a job, and da-da-da-da, all these ridiculous things to them, the kind of things that you hear if you're out, what people think of out on the street. The people, these were millionaire shareholders saying horrible things to our indigenous women when they were up there trying to bring attention to something very important. So that's just among the many ways you can be an ally, and just a little bit of what we do in terms of our people.
So you had not only an ally, but an accomplice, which is great.
Even better.
When you were here last year, we were also talking about the notion of all the folks coming in together, indigenous peoples from around the world, and how that has brought you together in a way that maybe you hadn't experienced before, because geographically, you're spread all over the globe. So Standing Rock also became a very sacred space, and also became kind of a sacred moment in the history of indigenous nations around the world. So I'm wondering, a year later now, if those connections have held, and if you are doing things in terms of decolonizing the globe together.
Well, I think that's what the United Nations Permanent Forum on Indigenous Peoples started to accomplish, is it making a platform mm-hmm. for all the issues as they come up. And and what we try to tell people is, like, with the DAPL, the pipeline, do you really want oil in your drinking water? These are universal issues. They may be on native land, mm-hmm. so it looks like it's our problem to get them to move it. But do you really think this is a great idea? Having a pipeline that might leak, pipes burst every minute. It's like, these are like what Rick was alluding to, is that, we're in this time where we have this technological ability to actually do things in a different way that it minimizes our own impact on ourselves. Like, we're very disconnected as Western society from our actual physical selves. We're looking for cancer cures instead of the root cause of cancer. Mm-hmm. Which might be pollutants. Mm-hmm. And yeah, we don't know. I don't have the answers, but I do know that trajectory is like, you can treat the symptoms all you want. Mm-hmm. What about the cause? Where is this actually starting? And it's for everybody. When we're champions of the natural, you should see the protests. I'm Quakers, they just pop up everywhere, communists, people that you just, real good people believe in this, better society, better. Mm-hmm. And downstairs where you have a beautiful slogan mm-hmm. in front of the, yeah. about the higher, prayer, holy is where people meet for the higher. And that's really, I think, the message that I would try to impart. That, you know, because we're often, you know, we do have a cultural legacy. You saw our drum, our beat of the nation, our songs used in protest. It's a medicine song. It's a healing song from the Cheyenne of Wyoming.
Before I open it up for Q&A, I'd like to ask you, because we have a weekly lunch discussion on Thursdays, and one of the articles that we read were about how the challenges that that Native Americans face with younger generations. And we particularly learned about how the Mohawk are forming language nests and cultural nests to educate young people. So I'm wondering, and we talked, Ben and I talked a little bit yesterday about the challenge with the younger generation, perhaps even more so, it's difficult to compare the colonists with technology, where you know they're on the internet all the time. So I'm wondering, how are you doing, you know, with teaching with the culture to a younger generation?
Okay, so I have two daughters. One of them started in a whole Mohawk immersion school in pre-K, which was, I guess, the first year in development. She lasted maybe till grade one. Then we started to panic. People were starting to talk like, oh, they're not going to be prepared to transfer into regular English school. So we took her out of that, put her in regular elementary school. And then my second daughter came along 4 years later, and we're good people up again. We speak Benegahat. So her name was, her name given at ceremony was She Kotep with him. So we decided that when she went in there, she had like more fire in her. And she was a very determined little girl. Very determined. Well spoken and okay, she's gonna be in this. And she's still in now. She's in grade seven. She's about to go into middle school. So she's carrying the language. She's for the past, my grandmother spoke fluent Binigeha. I spoke it for maybe three or four years of my life until I got thrown into school, and then it was just basically Mohawk, when I was speaking. My grandparents were straight out of the residential school system, so it was surprising that they still had the language. We have our own schools now, and part of decolonization ideas with my community is we need to start decolonizing education and start teaching in our language and us teaching us, and in our language, and that's what we have in development now. I think we might have maybe 500 Mohawk speakers under the age of maybe 12 or 13 from none, And then we have the elders and people that have been putting using technology to put together Mohawk learning software. So it's very modernized too. Even adults take classes and so forth, which is encouraged. We got a little bit of a threat from the government, maybe between 5 and 7 years ago, saying that, how Indian are you actually? Should we run through your DNA? Or you don't even speak your language. And we're kind of but you just stripped it from our grandparents, in the 80s. You just got done stealing our kids in the 60s scoop. You just stole all our kids, they lost their identity. And a lot of our grandparents didn't even survive the residential school system in Canada. They died, they were raped, they were beaten. The whole idea was take the Indian out of the child, kill the Indian and the child, keep the child. So all that intergenerational trauma is what we're fighting with. There's a lot of internal conflict, but we're dealing with it, and by dealing with it, we're trying to go back to our traditional ways and what's natural to us and what works.
Thank you. So, any questions? Yes, Howard?
I'm making guesses about the word decolonization just by looking at it and listening to it. Can you give me a better definition of decolonization?
What's your working definition when you do these things?
You know, it's a really good question because it's very politicized around this kind of who has the power to say what, where, when, and how. And so what that means in our community is that it's really about engagement of the people and not having a preset agenda that you want validated when you come into our community. And so that's like the scenario we deal with all the time. Mm-hmm. Groups call us, we want you to come up and, you know, we're going to do this thing and we're going to have this Mother Earth and that's it. You know, and they don't ask, do you think it's a problem? What would you like to do? Do you have a leader that is worse than this? So the decolonization for us is a practice where we're continually redirecting anybody coming into our community and people, Indians can be colonized as well, to talk to your own community. Don't be making decisions about them. So it's about this engagement. That's what it means to me. When you decolonize, it's a practice of actually slowing down and doing consultation with people.
And I would add that, as I said in the beginning, it means to dismantle sort of the assumptions and the premises that are colonial. Because if you dismantle them and you question them, and you take down that sort of colonial infrastructure, you move away that curtain of colonial infrastructure, you might find that there's original indigenous knowledge and ways that are actually better. You know, not just an alternative, but they may even be better. Or they may be something that could coexist side by side, where one doesn't simply suppress entirely the other, right? That they can actually work together, you know, they can exist together. And Liz can tell you more about the Haudenosaunee philosophy of two roads, but that was the concept there, is that we're always going to have different cultures, but they can coexist side by side. They can travel down this river of life together. But in some cases, I think that if that sort of that infrastructure, that colonial, you know, sort of power can be somewhat, you know, reduced and cleared enough that people can look into the indigenous way of doing things that was going on here thousands of years. They might say, wow, there's really something in there we can learn from. There's something in there that we can come to know and come to use in the way we all of us live our lives. So some people think, oh, they decolonize means that, oh, indigenous will be on top now. We'll be in charge. But that's not what it means. It means that it'll give everyone a chance to understand who we are and what our knowledge is and what our ways are. And in the interest of teaching, I'll just say something really quick. Does anybody speak an indigenous language? Anybody know one? Okay, just for educational purposes, I'm going to teach you one word. It's to say hello in my language. How about?
Oh,
there you go. Now you've learned at least one indigenous word. So you can walk up to someone and say, ha. You can say, hauka. And they'll say, what? And they'll say, that's hello and kumiai, an indigenous language, right? Melissa and Danica maybe teaches them. But then that's a way to start a conversation. Language is always a way to start a decolonization conversation. Because people will say, what? Indigenous? Yeah. Keep in mind, there were hundreds of indigenous languages on this land for thousands of years before, you know, English was planted on it. And linguists have now looked to indigenous languages and found out, you know what? There's greater complexity in many ways around indigenous languages than the word English, right? And there's ways in which we can understand the world through indigenous languages that you simply cannot understand through English. So
can you tell us about that two roads? And I imagine that in your history, given that you brought first five nations and then a sixth together, that you had to learn good communication skills, nonviolent communication, consensus building.
Yeah. I just want to digress a little bit.
Sure.
The question earlier about decolonization. To simplify that, I would define it as dismantling hierarchy.
And here you
dismantling
hierarchy. And also existed coexisting and realizing that you're equal to the land, you're equal to the birds, everything that grows, everything that is here to support our sustainable life, everything living, we're equal to that. The moment you don't acknowledge that or respect that is when the world's going to start collapsing around us. And in our language, in Mohawk, it's very different from the English language. It's not colonized, obviously, but we refer to all these things as equal as. You know, not as just objects, but as equal. And when we speak a traditional way of thinking and acknowledgement and existence, coexistence, which is another segue back to the two level one concept. We are here to verbal. The idea behind it is that we're to exist, to treat that we're going to coexist in peace. We're not going to disrupt your way of life. Vice versa. We're not to disrupt each other's way of life. They differ immensely.
Yes, I don't know your name, but yes.
My name is Emily, and I'm a lawyer. I'm representing the Narragansett Community Tribal Historical Preservation Office on our pipeline, and I've been doing pipeline work for almost 6 years now. And so first I want to thank all of you for coming and being here and for surviving and for trying to keep culture alive and to rerun it, because we all have to do this. So, whatever our culture or background, we were all indigenous. I like to say you may disagree with us, but we were all indigenous at one point. And we're in basic relationship with the Earth, we're indigenous. So I do have a really difficult question. Which is that it's in terms of language, I thought that the eastern edge of North America was connected through language, the Algonquin speaking people. Maybe we can clarify this. And so are the is the Mohawk just slightly to the west of that and not an Algonquin speaking people?
We have different languages.
Right.
But even amongst the Iroquois, which are a confederacy of six nations, there's different dialects and different words.
So,
we're definitely different than the Algonquin, but we're still able to communicate. We weren't a written language. We were like a treaty belt. It's symbolic. It represented, that treaty had a meaning because of what happened to our language. Same thing might happen to your language in 1,000 years, but we have this symbolic item that's like acting as a contract between us.
So in terms of where we are right here, on this spot on the earth, is this Algonquin speaking territory?
Well,
was it, so I'm a little confused about this, so that's
right.
Really my question.
We know from place names, there's a lot of indigenous place names that you'll tell us about Manhattan or Delaware or, places that wherever you see the word devil on a map, like Devil's Lake, Devil's River, Devil Hill, Devil's Gully. It was usually a holy place where they get them born. Christians came and said, they worship the devil. So we know from the oppression that, there were people that would come and go, and sometimes there were truly hunting camps, and sometimes there were stationary cities where our people would reside for a long time. So I think it's a really good question, because that goes back to the legal contest of proving validity or lineage, and then, are you really a person? Do you have rights?
I think that we need to start looking at the northeastern region as, an area that was, all the different nations, we're migration of people. So you can't attach us to one specific portion. Like, we did not stay on one area. We moved around. We planted our seeds. We, according to the climate and the season, we would move. We migrated. And when we planted our seeds, we would then move the next season after that harvest, so that line could repair itself. And so we basically migrated all over the region, and I think that's something that needs to be more discussed, because people are attaching we're not being in Manhattan, certain people in certain places, but I think it's basically a colonized idea. Maybe when they got here, this is where we were, and they're they're there. That's their territory. No, this is not how we operated in our community structures.
And along with that, language is also a very colonial, that conception of language families, and Algonquin is a language family, is also, I'll just say, it's white scholars. It's white scholars who came up with to conceptualize things that way. There's interconnectedness around language, but we had some, there were some ways in which we had universal languages. We had sign, we had, you know, we had other ways in which we communicated that did fall within sort of the specific way in which white scholars looked at communication. And so even verbal language, you know, is more complex than just saying, oh, that's the language family of those people or that people, you know, because that was what scholars try to do in order to sort of always trying to corral us, always trying to, you know, trying to codify us, always trying to categorize us in a way that gave them power over what we were, you know?
I think we have time for, I hope you're able to stay for lunch. Because I think we're gonna have a lot more questions, but we have time for a couple more. So Ken?
Yeah, I would like to know what your attitude for science is. I mean, science seems to me to be extremely important, and it seems to me that it's very important that the kids learn science in the school. Is that the case?
We know that educationally, indigenous students do not have access to appropriate science instruction, so when they go to apply to university, they're not even competitive. Mm-hmm. And so we know that it's a huge barrier for us as a community to not have access to educational resources. And a lot of it's because the teachers come and go and they're not from our community and they weren't allowed to become teachers and then be a teacher's assistant. But go do it. So. And then we have a community member here too who may have something to say.
My name is Cheryl Dupree, and I'm from the Cheyenne River Reservation. And as any warrior would know, if you call yourself a warrior, I'm a warrior from lineage, heritage, and the U.S. military system. I spent 33 years in the military. But if you talk about colonization basically colonization, where they're trying to establish that, is that they want property. So if you own this corner, and we can identify that you're the one that owns that corner, then that's what they're going to deal with. So they would rather get rid of you, remove you off of that ownership, and take that property. I come from a culture of treaties, and to this day, we're still fighting for our treaties. And I just learned recently from my tribe that my great-grandfather owned a lot of property in the Black Hills. Both my grandfathers, my great-grandfather, my great-great-grandfather, worked for the U.S. military, and this is something that I was told by my family, but we could never validate it. But decolonization, the basic thought behind that is they want our land, so they want to remove us if you have no ownership. But we never owned anything. We always share language. We share. If I couldn't get along with your language, we did sign language. We always communicated. So language was important on all sides, but it doesn't define definitely a tribe or a people that migrated. I come from a name called Minikosian, which has been changed over the years, but Minikosian basically means is the people who follow the waters. So my tribes follow the waters, and through the seasons, we've gone all the way down to Mexico and up to Canada. So people are saying that we're the people who plant by the waters, but we never plant. When we take something from the ground, we put it back. But we don't harvest and plant. So that's my opinion.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Cheryl. I was going to mention just one more thing about science. That's a perfect example where there could be a real sharing and coexistence, because there's been indigenous science forever. So we have science of our own. And we're not opposed to Western science. We believe there's a lot we can benefit from Western science. So the two can be used together. And I would let people know, if you want a reference on this, she happens to be my goddaughter, and she's also a professor at Memorial University in Newfoundland, Canada. Her name is Max Liberone. If you want to see how a scientist, which she is with a doctorate, I mean, she has all the Western credentials, and she's Métis, so she's indigenous, she's Aboriginal. If you want to see how she's taken indigenous science knowledge and Western science knowledge and really done amazing things with it, look anything up by her. It's Max, and then Libiron. If you want to hear it later, I'll give it to you.
And we'll make sure we record some.
But some of these questions are so complex, it's better to go to a reference and see what people are doing around this.
We're having such a great time, but we do need to move on, and we have lunch upstairs on the sixth floor. Afterwards, so we hope that you can stay. And I just want to thank you so very much. And we will put information about how.
how we can be better allies, accomplices, how we can have more information, and we'll get that out to everyone on our website and on our Facebook page. So thank you so very much.